begin to turn on more than 100 college campuses scattered across China. Faithful servants like this clang old brass school bells. Proud once again to call China's youth into halls of modern higher learning. As you watch these intent, intelligent, and attractive faces, you see here the world's greatest reservoir of undeveloped human ability, and understand why these campuses are the battleground on which the democratic way of life is contending in the gigantic struggle that now shakes the Far East. This film tells of 13 Christian colleges that are literally the front line of this democracy. Their story began more than 100 years ago in old China. Old China, fundamental China, still a land of simple mechanical processes and masses of sturdy people, deep-rooted and solid underneath the furor of conflict and change. Majestic China, beautiful China, land of massive city walls and gold-roofed temples, where red-robed Lamaic priests tell their beads amid a rich and ancient culture. Land of narrow, crowded city streets, of villages by the tens, by the hundreds of thousands. A rugged land with mighty, muddy rivers that burst their dikes to drown people by families and by villages. Land of drought and famine, where the great majority of folk toil on the soil with hoe and iron-shared wooden plow, planting and irrigating, harvesting and trading, producing barely enough to maintain life, spinning and weaving with simple tools the coarse cloth of everyday wear. A land where goods and people move on man-towed boats and wooden-wheeled carts. On wheelbarrows and on springy carrying poles that many times bear down on the shoulders of men who are sick or crippled. Old China, land of backbreaking toil, poverty, ignorance, and disease, where life was limited by the use of only those primitive forces generated by muscle, wind, and water. Into that old China came the missionary pioneers, driven by the conviction that all men are the sons of God, bringing with them the best of Western civilization. One of the first things they did was to start primary schools, schools much simpler than those you see here, but destined to grow into colleges and universities. Thus, by 1937, there were 13 Christian colleges in China, functioning as full-blown demonstrations of the Christian way of life. These colleges were Yen Qing, Qi Du, West China Union, Hua Chung, Jinling, University of Nanking, Su Chao, Hang Chao, St. John's, University of Shanghai, Hua Nan, Fujian Christian University, and Ling Nan. 10 years ago, life on these campuses was vigorous and effective. Suddenly, peace was shattered. Japan was out to force her co-prosperity sphere on East Asia. The shadow of her might fell across China. Bombs smashed down. Flames whipped through 100 cities. So the colleges set out to find places where their work could go on. Around the fighting fronts they went, up the rivers, across the dry plains of North China. The map came alive with their going. Some packed books and equipment, others fled so fast they could take nothing. cities to which they went were bombed again and again. These were the years when America, not yet realizing that the fate of China is vital to us, was still selling gasoline and scrap to the Japanese. But between air raids, the Christian colleges went right on with the business of training young men and women. Undaunted, they waged the endless battle of developing that knowledge and character which alone can rebuild the world. Their graduates poured out to play a valiant part in China's lone war effort. Then, 4.5 years later, America's time came, and the bombs fell on Pearl Harbor. So the physical plants of colleges caught in enemy territory were occupied. Many students and teachers filtered through the lines to join institutions already in the interior or to build new campuses. The track of these migrations of the fifth war year, added to those of the first, literally traversed the whole of China. To visualize the distances, we superimposed the map of the United States. Faith and the dollars given by friends around the world kept the colleges in exile going. Then, in July 1945, atomic bombs with a single blast wiped out whole cities. As suddenly as the declaration of war came the surrender, victory. China was a partner in winning a modern war. Months went by, the roads began to open, the colleges could go home, and a journey that was even slower and more difficult than the migration inland got underway. Days were spent waiting to ferry across swollen rivers. Destroyed and war-torn roads turned to mud under slow-moving wheels as worn-out trucks swept up and down the mountainous terrain, but hearts were high because the way was toward home. Clumsy Yangtze junks finally pulled into shore. The long journey was done, and young passengers ran down the gangplank. This man, burned black from weeks of exposure, does not conform to the classical concept of a Chinese professor of philosophy, but that is what he is. Riding through the dangerous rapids of the famous Yangtze Gorges, he brings back this party of students and tons of books and equipment belonging to Jin Ling and the University of Nanking. These boxes contain equipment hauled out of Nanking just ahead of the looting Japanese. Much is worn out from 10 years of hard use and 2 long journeys, but till money is available to replace it, the broken down stuff in these boxes must equip the China colleges. Personal belongings go on the trucks, suitcases, bedrolls, deck chairs that ease the 6-week journey down the river. These students, enrolled in exile, are eager for the first glimpse of the home campus of their university. This veteran of 40 years college service, left behind when the college migrated, waves a welcome home. Eager hands help the homecomers down and reach for their baggage. Everywhere, the philosophy professor and his group of returning exiles are received with joy. In this fashion, the colleges brought back their faculties and equipment to campuses that seemed from the outside much as before the war. sessions and their moments of relaxation and fun, the students resume a normal college life. There are competitive sports to develop physical stamina and the spirit of teamwork so necessary for the difficult and dangerous years ahead. Students go trooping from classes to chapel and back to classes again. There are many hours of concentrated study in the quiet of dormitory rooms. Study that supplies the knowledge, shapes the purposes, and nurtures the character needed for the rebuilding of China. But as they study, these young people are deeply aware of the pressing unsolved problems of their country. Problems rooted in old China, but, as this Japanese pillbox reminds us, problems made more acute by the war. What are these basic problems of China? China needs more food to fill the stomachs of her hungry millions. China needs conservation to save the soil, prevent floods, and harness her rivers. China needs industry to replace hand methods with modern tools and vastly expand production. China needs better health to prevent sickness and cure disease, to protect the new generation. China needs education for children and adults alike. And she needs information poured out through all the mass media so the people can know the truth. China needs to develop and maintain sound democratic government. China needs religion, needs new moral and spiritual standards, a gospel of hope for men and women struggling against heartbreaking difficulties. China needs all these things. The whole world needs them. None of us can have peace. The American way of life will never be secure till the people of the world solve these problems. To provide more food, plant breeders trained in the Christian colleges are producing, by careful cross-pollination and selection, improved strains and varieties of basic crops, wheat, cotton, corn, and scores of others. Students learn new and better methods of cultivation. Better seed and better methods will produce more food and a better livelihood for China's millions. College-trained civil engineers will build the dams and construct the irrigation systems which will harness China's rivers and convert them from China's sorrows to sources of wealth. Back from exile, their limited equipment reassembled, these colleges go on educating scientists, technicians, and managers for the industrialization of China. Alumni, like this manager of the municipal power plant at Nanjing, will create the plants to lay on machines the burdens old China has borne with human sweat and blood. Out of Christian medical, pre-medical, and nursing schools have come a host of trained doctors and nurses. These, with hundreds of students now in Christian colleges, will carry on the battle for better health. Like Dr. Miao in Shanxi, they too will carry on despite the wreckage of war and limited equipment. A sterilizer in the backyard, if necessary, heated by a charcoal fire fanned by a hand-pumped bellows. With determination such as this, a There will be adequate medical care someday for every baby in all China. One half of all Christian college students enter the field of education, working at every level from village kindergarten to advanced research. Out of the books in these libraries, Chinese students draw on the best of Western culture for the building of the new China. Though they now must work in unheated reading rooms where padded garments and woolen mittens are the only protection from the cold. Audio-visual aids and all the media of mass information are stressed as vital fighting forces in the war of ideas which is being waged in China. Colleges serve as centers for the production, the public display, and the distribution of educational films and film scripts. Student technicians from science classes help operate university broadcasting stations, which carry to increasing thousands help on personal problems and information on the world at large. Last Christmas, the story of the Holy Birth, with its richness of pageantry and music, brought through such a radio hope and a sense of common brotherhood to the hearts of men. Outstanding leaders, European and Chinese, bring information and inspiration to prepare China's masses for a more intelligent participation in democratic government. Democratic government operating under law must be achieved before China and the world can have peace and security. Here, law students are learning how to make that law work through moot court. If a society is to rest on law, its legal profession must have integrity. Christian colleges transmit that integrity. But even more important than the training of lawyers, the entire student body meets and solves its problems in the spirit and by the methods of democracy. Staff and graduates are active in promoting good government in civil life. Dr. Wu Yi Fang, president of Jinling, served for many years on the presidium of the People's Political Council. She and many others trained by these colleges participated in the National Assembly that debated and adopted China's new constitution. Thus, the colleges strive, often against great difficulties, to help achieve the ideals of Sun Yat-sen and his three people's principles. Nationalism, the survival of the nation free and independent. Democracy, literally the people's authority to govern. Livelihood, the achievement of freedom from want. Building a China in which these principles can be realized is a long, hard job. The colleges are a significant part of the growing edge of democracy in the world. These are Christian colleges. Voluntary Bible classes are but one of the ways they teach the Christian message and demonstrate the Christian way of life. Their life flows out into the community through graduates, like Pastor Lee, who works in a rural church. He labors among the well-to-do and the poor alike, entering into their daily lives, sharing their work and problems, seeking to bring them new ways of living and new hope. But there are millions of women like this who have no Christian pastor. All along the line, the Christian colleges are meeting the challenge of China's needs. The ruins 10 years of international war have left intensify these vital problems of China. Now civil war adds further difficulties. Still, the leaders of these colleges keep strong this front line of the battle for a better way of life. Here are some of the leaders, presidents, deans, faculty members, and administrators. They face the problem of students asleep on floors, staff crowded into inadequate quarters, laboratories and classrooms still stripped of equipment. Under skyrocketing inflation, they must find the money merely to feed the faculty. Monthly salaries that represent but a third of pre-war purchasing power must now be reckoned in the millions of Chinese dollars. Yet there is no wavering in the devotion and loyalty of these teachers to the things these colleges stand for. On this front, though the line is thin and ragged, it still fights forward. From China, the New York Herald Tribune's veteran Far East correspondent A.T. Steele writes, "There is one point on which virtually all observers agree. The Christian colleges have done their job well." Continuing, he says, "No influence has made a bigger contribution to democratization and general advancement. They have served as show windows of Western learning and nurseries of democratic thought. Has it been worth the cost and effort? Call the roll of the men who are at the top in China today, and you will find a surprisingly large proportion who got their start in Christian colleges. The Christian colleges went through a trying ordeal during the war. Crippled in plant, staff, and financial resources, they are overwhelmed with their greatest